Dear Facebook Pure Urology viewers, good evening one and all. Like every day or alternate day, we are doing surgical technique based videos. Today we are doing it little more different, not only the surgery but the cadaveric dissection videos also. The topic is female urethra in relation to the incontinence, in relation to the parvaginal surgery, in relation to the cystocele, in relation to the enterocele, everything what that looks from the vagina urology perspective. Usually we don't visualize certain things in this area. We only see urethra, we only see bladder, we only see vaginal wall, we see the cervix, os, but lot of connective tissues, named, unnamed, will be there, which will hold the entire body not coming down. There are angles in the bone, there are thickened tissues, that all we have to discuss today. It is a separate subspecialty. Our speaker is Dr. Ajit Vajay sir, which every Indian urologist of this generation knows, because he is a very very hard working, sincere, senior professor who has dedicated his career for urology, more so for female urology, more so for the vesicovaginal fistula, urethrovaginal fistula, prolapse, like these things. He is also the ex-president of Urology Society of India. Before Dr. Soundarya, who is a consultant urologist at Preeti Hospital, introduces sir officially through the PowerPoint presentation, I like to ask Ajit sir briefly about your career so that we get influence and we try to take the positive things from them. Good evening, sir. Ajit sir.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Chandramohan, it was a great meeting you, and under the leadership of Preeti Urology Kidney Hospital, I'm very, very happy and very proud to join as a Pure Urology, which
yes,
is a probably a hallmark of academic urology for last 1 year.
Sir, sir, please briefly, remember, you did your MBBS from which place, sir?
I did MBBS from KM Hospital.
KM, Bombay.
KM Hospital. Said GS Medical College and KM Hospital.
Very good. After that, MS, sir?
Then after that, I did MS General Surgery in KM Hospital.
Oh my God, great. And then
so I was the first student who passed out MCH Urology from University of Mumbai.
Oh great. From which college, sir? That
was from LTMG, Sion Medical College.
Sion, okay.
Because my teacher was Dr. S.D. Bapat.
Yeah.
Very prestigious and very astute clinician as well as academician.
Very nice.
And so I was the first MCH urology boy who appeared for MCH from Mumbai University way back in 1981.
Oh great, my God. So you, at that time, who was your mentor apart from Bapat sir? How you developed interest in female urology? When you developed interest in female urology?
It is very important to know, after doing almost 20 years of urology from 81 to 84, I was in United States.
Oh, is it? Uh-huh.
Yes. And in United States, I worked with three important parts. Number one was Mayo Clinic.
Okay.
Number two was Cleveland Clinic. And believe me, Dr. Chandramohan, what Cleveland Clinic I have seen, it was like a hutment area. But I was very close to Dr. Andrew Novick, as you know very well.
He
was
sir.
A very big doyen. And then later on, he became a chairman of urology. And now it's a Glickman Institute of Urology of Cleveland Clinic.
Yeah.
I started developing interest in female urology from 2001.
Yeah.
Now the problem is, little is known to both urologists and gynecologists about this watershed area. Almost 30 to 35% of urology and 30 to 35% gynecology is in that range of female urology.
So, of late, last 10 years, you
no no let me tell you, it's a very interesting 1 minute, I'll finish it off.
Yes sir.
So I said the best way is I have to go abroad and get myself trained in female urology.
Yes sir.
So I went to Dr. Shlomo Raj in UCLA in Los Angeles and spent 6 months with him.
Okay.
Then I came down to Cleveland Clinic next year and I spent 2 months in Cleveland Clinic.
Yeah, yeah.
Then afterwards, I went to Vanderbilt University with Professor Dr. Roger Dromachowski. He is now a chairman. In fact, today's the 12th edition of Campbell is done by Roger Dromachowski.
Oh, great.
So he is a chairman of Vanderbilt University. So in 2004, I said I must hold a urological meeting in India because it was still in infancy. So Dr. Shlomo Raj said, I will come for this thing. Do you know how many delegates were there in 2004? It is still one of the most memorable conferences. 1,500 delegates came for that conference.
Uh-huh.
Then thereafter, we became so close to each other that Professor Shlomo Raj came 6 times to India.
Very nice.
Then we did multiple conferences with him. Then almost all over, from 2010 onwards, I became very close to Chris Chappell, Professor Chris Chappell.
Very good.
And then I got very much dedicated to every year in European urology, there is a female urology masterclass.
Yes, sir.
Which is for 1 week. And from 2010 onwards, I have a faculty there till 2019. Last 2 years, there are no female urology courses because of the COVID situation both. And I don't know whether it is going to be there next year or not.
Yes, sir.
But I have gone several places and I got myself fully trained by these people.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Now, we, Dr. Soundarya, please officially introduce, sir. Today topic is female incontinence surgery and by animations and cadaver dissection we will understand. Dr. Soundarya is also a consultant urologist at Preeti Hospital focusing on female urology as well as thulium fiber laser. These are two areas of interest of her. Over to you, Soundarya.
Thank you for the opportunity, sir. Good evening, one and all, dear Pure Urology Facebook viewers. Here we have today Dr. Arjit Vaze, sir, our speaker. It is my pleasure to introduce him to you all. He has been associated with Leelavati Hospital and Research Center in Bandra, West Mumbai. He was the past president of USI, honorary member of European Urology. He has conducted 47 operative workshops of female urology in India and neighboring countries. He was the coordinator for female urology from 2007 to 2013 for USI. He has conducted symposium in Melbourne for SIU. He was the faculty for European Urology Masterclass in Female Urology from 2010 until 2019. He was the faculty for Female Urology at AUA in 2013 and 2015. He was the invited faculty for Female Urology in Egypt, Maldives, UAE, Oman, Nepal, and Bangladesh, where operative workshop and full-day symposium were conducted. And he has won the prestigious awards like Dr. G.M. Falke Award, CKP Menon Best Paper Award, and Best Paper in Messicon 1997, 98, and 99, and the Best Paper Award in the International Surgeon Conference in 1999. Also, he has written 3 chapters in female urology textbook, demonstrated several operations for AICOG from 2008, 2010, 11, 13, and 15, in their annual conferences. So over to you, sir. We are really having a great pleasure to have you here today. Over to you, Dr. Arjit Vaze, sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Soundarya, Dr. Chandramohan, and all his team. It is indeed a very important and very essential part in my life to be associated with a Preeti Urology Hospital and a very important, what is known as a pure urology, only for as an academic forum in urology. I'm going to take you to something very important today for next 45 to 50 minutes, and then I will keep 10 more minutes in order to have question answers or any other things together. I'm going to go very slowly. Are my slides
visible? Visible? Yes, sir. Audible, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. The female urology, as all of you know, it's a new, vibrant and rapidly upcoming specialty both in India as well as in Western world. This is a classical part where the two giant subspecialties, namely the gynecology and urology, is watershed area. Right from 2002 onwards, I've been in and out of female urology. But it is very important, just before I teach you or train you for incontinence surgery, you must know your basics well, namely the anatomy. The problem of our curriculum is that we are taught anatomy in first MBBS, and thereafter we have to literally go from one part to other to again relearn the anatomy. For last 25 years, the anatomy was taught as a line diagram, which was not very innovative. 10 years back, I first started showing a three-dimensional animation, which I'm going to show quite a few in order to ease the understanding. But now I have added one more facet in order to make the anatomy more easy, more simple, namely a cadaveric dissection in addition. I must first tell you candidly that I was taken for this cadaveric dissection course by my close friend, Dr. Helen McConnell. She is a professor of urology in Melbourne, Australia. And she was very gracious in 2012 to come to India, especially West Zone in Mehsana, and we conducted one full day of cadaveric course, and I'm going to show you some of the synopsis of that. The second person was Dr. Shailesh Shah, who was that time a secretary of West Zone. He also backed me, and thereafter we did a very good cadaveric dissection for the first time in West Zone urology. So from the line diagram, which you have seen it here, we have moved to something completely different. And I'm going to first tell you what is the complexity of the theater of female urology. If you see the bladder, if you see the reproductive system, and if you see the defecatory system is closely connected in the female perineum very closely. Now, gone are those days where people used to think that the first course was a muscle. It is a ligament that is the more important part together, but there are several, about 21 ligaments, which gives rise to what is known as more intricacy in the part. Third is the muscle, what is known as the levatorini, and it's all three components along which obturator and few other, which I'm going to describe in part, also forms what is known as a secondary base, so that you get a very complex type of anatomy, both ligaments as well as this. But very essential is you have to understand that there is a milieu interior, namely the opposite forces, which keeps the uterus, the puboerythral ligament, which is the mainstay of the portion, and the entire milieu interior absolutely intact. And let us go and see in over 45 minutes how it is come. The reason why a cadaveric course is in addition necessary in order to teach you or learn the nuances of anatomy is now it is actual 3D animation. But in addition to that, there is a tissue field. But please don't go with an idea that cadaveric dissection is an easy dissection, because most of the bodies are formalin preserved. There is only one place in whole of India, namely the Ramayya Institution, where the bodies are almost as fresh as ever. But still, there are few problems. If you dissect the artery and if you dissect the vein, the actual color is not present. And hence, you have to color that portion. And then in addition to that, in order to make it more interesting and more innovative, you have to have a classical marriage between 3D demonstration animation and the cadaveric courses, which will give a better applied anatomy and clinical significance. I have selected three areas in the body for female incontinence surgery. We will start with suprabibic area. Thereafter, we will go in what is known as obturate area. And then we'll go show you at different portions and different ways of a gluteal area, which will make the understanding much better. In suprabibic area, you have to understand this is essential for a TVT, a safe TVT demonstration. Second important thing, since as you know, that all over the world, there is a huge amount of mesh as far as a mesh is concerned. And in almost 27 countries all over the world, the classical TVT and TOT, which were made by Johnson and other people, have been banned. So therefore, last 4 or 5 years, the AFL, autologous facial tussling, has come in the huge prominence. And a suprabibic area will also give rise to what is, how do we do a autologous facial data and what are the other nuances. Third, there are several other things in addition to female urology, namely the inferior epigastric artery, can be used by andrologists for artificial penis creation. In neurogenic bladder, rectus abdominis, the lateral and medial head can be crisscrossed over each other and give rise to what it. And lastly, but there are several flaps which can give rise to. So let us go to what is known as a cadaveric dissection of a suprabibic area. This was conducted in 2013 under the leadership of Dr. Helen McConnell, and you will be surprised, we will be able to show you different parts together. So let us go in that part. When you dissect the first part of the lower flap, there are two things you will see it very clearly. One is a yellow color fat, what is known as a Camper's fascia, and a very thin or shiny layer, what is called a Scarpa's fascia. This is very essential, especially when you are looking at the dermal graft. Second important prominence thing is what is classically known as external oblique aponeurosis, which can be reflected by cutting in the midline. And in the below part, there is an external ring. In females, the content of external rings are round ligament and ilioinguinal nerves, which are coming to that. When you reflect the aponeurosis laterally, you can see a very clear position, what is known as an imaginary triangle, what is known as Hasselbalch triangle. We'll come to that. Third is rectus abdominis muscle. And there are two heads of rectus abdominis, lateral head and medial head. And you can easily cut together and hold in between. There is a vestigial muscle called pyramidalis, which is coming in front of that. Not much of a clinical significance to that. But here in suprabibic region, three important features. Number one is Hasselbalch triangle. Now this Hasselbalch triangle is a triangle. On the lateral aspect, there is inferior epigastric artery and vein together. On a medial aspect, this lateral part of rectus abdominis muscle. And inferiorly is incurred portion of inguinal ligament. As you all know very well, the inguinal ligament is coming from anterior superior iliac fascia right up to the pubic symphysis. And that gives a very strong, powerful demarcation between abdominal cavity and the thigh cavity together. Now, once that is taken care of, if you see classically, the importance of Hasselbalch triangle is three. Number one, for a general surgeon, a direct hernia comes from there. But for a urologist, when you're doing autologous facial artery sling, you put three small devas retractor, and when you put it in the, this area does not have any great artery, vein, or any blood supply together. And therefore, you can do the artificial autologous fascia under vision, and then comes on the lateral aspect that. If you put on the opposite side, you see what is known as inferior gluteal artery and vein, and that arborizes with the superior gluteal artery and opposite side together. The superior gluteal artery is a form of inferior phrenic artery together. Now, posterior to that is a posterior rectus sheath, what is called, also called as Thompson's fascia. This Thompson fascia can be also used very efficaciously if the anterior part is not present for autologous facial artery. Below that is a peritoneum, and peritoneum covers the bladder and in part on the superior as well as lateral or anterior lateral part. When you reflect the peritoneum, you slowly come down to what is known as retroperitoneum. And in retroperitoneum, there are three important structures you see. One is the external iliac artery. You can see we have colored it red, the external iliac vein. And in between, there is a cord-like structure, which people think that it is something, a nerve, but it is not a nerve, but it is a round ligament, which gives a support to the lateral wall of uterus and comes and circumvents from the inferior epigastric artery, goes down into the external ring and gets attached to the Mons and other pubic symphysis place. So once you do that, I'll go a little faster because I want to show you a large amount of things together. Now, when you come to the retroperitoneum, the three most important part is obturator nerves and vessels. We have put a special yellow color sling. You can see it very clearly. And that obturator, it is also associated along with that, there is artery and a vein also together. This forms a very important structure in female urology. And in when you're doing in general surgery, you have to must avoid injury to obturator vessel because adduction of the entire hip is dependent on that portion. When we put a TVT needle from below, and you will see it within just no minute, few milliseconds, you can see clearly. So here I'm putting what is known as a TVT needle. You can see it very clearly. Gone are those days for the robust TVT needle. Today, the TVT exact is the same thing is used for that. So this is the best or safest way of putting a TVT from below, but it comes with a good amount of practice. You must see that when the TVT is put, it is in the harm's way. It doesn't affect the urethra. It doesn't affect the bladder. But few little milliseconds of delay in vaginal wall, the usually obturator veins, or if the bravado continues, extra iliac vein, also comes in a position to get. So summarizing the suprapubic area for female urology, three important things. Number one, Hasselbeck triangle, where you can do what is known as a visual inspection of the finger when you are put from below. When you are put or cut the endopelvic fascia, you can see and you can put the artificial facial artery needle go and you can see the sling coming out. Second, you can put the sling on the lateral aspect of rectus muscle so that unnecessary tension and thereafter voiding dysfunction is avoided. And three, how to put the TVT needle very safely inside that. You have to go skirting below the inferior pubic rami. And you and before that, I'll show you several other dissection of the cadaver. You can see it very clearly with the good and judicious use of a guide rod, which are present in that, you can avoid the injury to the urethra as well as the bladder together. We'll go ahead because I have to show you a several large amount of part together. And then now you can understand when you see the diagrams like this, the needle coming out, why does the patient gets a pain after TVT, or if there is a bleeding, why does it happen together? You can see it very clearly that you can have accessory obturator vein or external iliac vein if the thing goes little lateral, few milliseconds at the vaginal wall. If the learning curve is not there, you can have a very disastrous result in the part together. Second is, most of the time when you are putting the TVT, make sure that the patient's cave of Retzius is virgin, or if not, then you have to use it with a great care, because if there are multiple caesarean section, the needle will come, but will come through either a small or large bowel, which will give rise to perforation. And that is the reason why today, even today, when it came in 1996 with big fanfare, you will be surprised, it was something like a Brahmastra or the final panacea, but it was no longer true by 2001. The zone of safety was reduced to almost very minimum, and therefore many people went in what is known as a TOT fixation. Now, there are several ways you can, we have done several cadaveric dissection, and this is one aspect you saw it, but the second aspect I want to show also you is what is known as a hemipelvis. And the hemipelvis, when you put that together, this is a guide rod which is moving, going from one part to other. One simple principle when you are putting a TVT, suppose you are putting a TVT needle on right side, make sure that the rod goes on the right side and opposite side has to be completely fixed. And that is only way where the part together, it comes in a very perfect way, avoiding injury to the urethra, avoiding injury to the bladder, and avoiding injury to the great vessel on lateral aspect part together. So the hemipelvis, which is what is known as the transverse hemipelvis, will give rise to this kind of part together. Then we did a laparoscopy in order to find out how does the actual needle come. So if you see, the actual needle comes in the way, and you can still see that the plastic sheet is still present. And that is the important part, because unless the plastic sheet is there, it will have a twisting and turning. And that is how the situation comes to mind. And that is the final result. Thereafter, you have to remove the plastic sheet. You make sure that it remains as a non-tension TVT. And that gives us a wonderful result together. You also see the puboerythral ligament. And in fact, the entire today's system that is known as integral therapy is based upon laxity of puboerythral ligament. And there are several ways you can easily diagnose. From below, putting endopelvic fascia, you can push the puboerythral ligament medially together. And that is a way, another way. Another way of giving a good demonstration, especially in a cadaver, is what is known as a hemidissection. And here in hemidissection, you can see it, only one part of the cadaver is there, other part is not there. And you see, this is the way how we do dissection, especially in a small newer incision. You can see it very clearly that when you put a tine rod, it gets attached to obturator internus muscle, and the division is very fast. So even if you pull it with very large might, the small tape doesn't come out. This is classical demonstration of a mini arc, which came in 2006. And unfortunately, even today, after 15 years, it has not stood the test of the time today. We'll have to wait for some time because there is a small little error which has happened. So please bear with me. You can see it very well. When the patient have a poor cave of Ridges because of multiple cesarean section, multiple things in past. They come, but they give rise to a lot of problem. And therefore, you must realize, even though on the paper, the area is demarcated as a safe area, TVT has its own place even today in 2021. But you have to use a great amount of caution and a very good part together. The obturate area is a second area I'm going to describe you. In this, we have to understand that there are lots of problems because of the disastrous TVT complication and almost 32 deaths in the part together. The problem, people started wanting to have a safe procedure. The trouble was the TOT, the anatomy was only taught in the first MBBS and thereafter never again. So therefore, here am I giving you what is known as a newer anatomy of an obturate area. The obturate area is the obtuse area on the lateral aspect of part. And this is covered by four important muscles: obturator externus, adductor magnus, which is a wide body, adductor brevis, which is a small body, and adductor longus. And that is a very important portion of that. So four important muscles. After that, you see the nerves and vessel in obturator vessel come on outer and lateral side. And all the TVT or TOT comes from medial spine. So it sustained a very safe distance of 2 to 2.5 centimeter. And thereafter is the third important thing. The obturator nerve divides into two parts, anterior division and a posterior division. Anterior division is between adductor longus and adductor brevis. That is what it is seen here. While the posterior division, which gets most of the time neuropraxia occurs, it is between adductor brevis and adductor magnus muscle. Now the artery, obturate artery, is completely supported by obturator fossa and divided into anterior posterior. The important structure or relevance is that in this structure, once the learning curve is over, you do not get what is known as arterial bleeding. Most of the bleeding is venous, and the venous bleeding can be easily covered and taken. So we have done several ways. Once you know the anatomy, you can see it very clearly. The wide body is what is known as adductor magnus muscle. We have cut the adductor brevis. This is the tape which goes below adductor longus muscle. You can see it very clearly. We will cut open the adductor long. So that is the adductor magnus muscle. Once you cut the adductor magnus muscle, there is adductor brevis muscle which comes out. Once you cut the adductor brevis muscle, you can see clearly the shiny area of obturator. You can see within few milliseconds, you will see it very clearly. And you see on the outer and lateral surface, it comes together. So you can see very clearly that the obturator membrane is supported by three important structures. Number one, obturator externus muscle, adductor magnus muscle, brevis muscle, and adductor longus is little far away part together. So this is how the situation is from the part together. Now, once you start dissecting part, you can see clearly on outer and lateral surface, the nerves and vessel come in, and you can see clearly that is the nerve. And this nerve is usually the posterior division because anterior division goes anterior. So when you palpate from below on the from the vagina portion, that is where the entire TOT comes together. So let us see once in a other cadaver, when you put the needle from outside in, what is classically known as Monarch procedure, and when you dissect the body together with the ring together, you can see it still subtend a almost 3 centimeter distance from each other. That is the best way in order to avoid the problems together. In the same way, when you put the TOT needle together, it comes at the medial as well as inferior portion very long way, arm's way from the obturator vessel, almost 2 to 2.5 centimeters, safe distance from that portion. So TOT definitely has classically what is known as a very, very high and very long safe record right from 2001 onwards down up to today, 2021. Now let us see. So that when you see the TVT animation, what we do, TOT
begins with a 1 centimeter mid-perineal membrane. We take 1 centimeter, traveling laterally and away from the dorsal nerve. The pathway extends outward at a 45 degree angle towards the medial and inferior to the origin of the pubococcygeus and puborectalis muscles, and below the arcus tendineus, levator ani, and then laterally out through the obturator membrane. Once through the obturator membrane, the tract passes through the obturator externus muscle, the superior end of the adductor magnus muscle, the adductor brevis muscle, and the upper edge of the gracilis muscle, fascia lata, small part, subcutaneous tissues, and begins with a one.
So there are several ways we have done a dissection part together, and you can see it very clearly. So when we see the needle location and you dissect in a hemipelvis where the needle is put together while you are dissecting, you will see the same part, gracilis muscle, thereafter adductor magnus muscle, which is very thick muscle, thereafter, adductor brevis muscle, which is a small muscle just below the and medial to part together. Thereafter, you see obturator externus muscle. You will see obturator membrane, a glistening or shining membrane, and you can see the needle, which is on medial side of the part, giving rise to arm's way from part together. If you don't keep the mistake, you will see the certain complication. For example, this was the patient who, after putting a TOTV, was referred because she could not pass urine. So look at the large amount of hematoma, which is still present here. You can see it classically. We needed to aspirate it and remove it together. If the same thing continues, you can see the large amount of hematoma all over the body, and this is not uncommon. The reason is obturator vessel has a lot of abnormalities, and if there is aberrant vessel which is present, that can come in harm's way, and sometimes aberrant vessels can give rise to a part and give rise to a potential bleeding. Now, if the TOT goes away, how do you go about it? There are three ways of putting it, and I'll just quickly show you a part. This tape has been given to me by Dr. James Moore, and you can see it very clearly. We'll show you a few meter. The outer part, you can cut it under vision. Thereafter, you can go 1 to 1.5 centimeter medially. The other way is you have to do laparoscopically, and you have to remove and just follow the TOT tape in the part. The reason why the TOT tape gives rise to pain is it usually goes around the obturator nerve, and you can see it very clearly in this. That is a remnant of the TOT part, and we are just dissecting in the retroperitoneum, and you can see clearly that it has come very close and almost circumducting to the obturator nerves and vessel. And you can see that is the obturator nerve which is separated out, and that is the tape which is coming right to that. So we will stop it here and then go move ahead, because I want to show you a large amount of part. This is a very interesting video which I want to show you. And here we wanted to do, how does the tape comes together? So what I did was, I did a TOT under a image intensifier. And here, this is a preparation which is going on. Once the preparation going on, the dissection comes on the right-hand side, the patient's right-hand side. And once you do a dissection with the help of MedSap bomb scissor, when you put on the click, you can see clearly it. The dissection is only up to the medial portion of obturator membrane. Thereafter, the guide rod comes only up to the portion together. Then the needle comes behind that, and then you drop the needle so that the tip starts looking upstairs vertically and it comes together. And you can see clearly that is how the similar portion can be done on opposite side. The two important things here is very important that this is the first time somebody has done a TOT under image intensifier in order to find out whether what is the exact course the needle takes, because once the dissection comes from the vaginal area, everything is blind. But with the judicious use of obturator, the similar procedure we can do in opposite side. And you can see the assistant is putting the tape exactly in little taut position. So opposite side, you can see it's opening up. Thereafter, you can see classically, a guide rod is placed in the same pre-part together, and then the needle goes together. The needle traverses very comfortably from obturator internus to membrane. There are two pop theory. Then you drop the needle so that it starts looking vertically towards, and thereafter the needle comes in. Very essential. Thereafter, the guide rod is taken away, and then the needle is pushed up so that it becomes horizontal, it starts looking towards, and that is the safest area in order to do a TOT put together. So this is the first time somebody has done a TOT under classical, what is known as, once that is taken care of, once the metallic portion is removed of the part, you will see it with image intensifier, everything gets completed. Because a plastic cannot be seen by a metallic portion, and therefore you become again the same blind once put together. So metallic portion, once it is removed, you will see the tape is never seen together. That is a hemostat which is holding the tip of the portion. You can see I am removing the entire metallic part of the part together, and the tape becomes completely invisible together. We'll stop it here because I have to show you a large amount of part together. The third part is what is known as a gluteal region, which is very interesting, but I have shown you in a different part together. So let us look at the gluteal region here. Once the dissection from the posterior aspect, the skin is removed, The second very important portion which comes out is gluteus maximus muscle. And if you cut medially the gluteus maximus muscle, you will see a very important artery and vein part together, inferior gluteal artery. There are two parts. On the superior aspect, there is a superior gluteal artery, but inferior gluteal artery comes exactly in the center of that portion. Now, once you see the inferior gluteal artery, it is a division of posterior artery, iliac artery. Below that is classically known as a sacral nerves. You can see it in a minute together. And this sacral nerve is safeguarded by a very important muscle. That is a sacral nerve part. That is safeguarded by piriformis muscle. You can see it very clearly from here. Once it reflects outside, you can see the muscle which is supporting and safeguarding the sciatic nerve, that is known as a piriformis muscle together. Thereafter, we have to cut what is known as a sacrotuberous ligament from sacral tuberosity to sacrum. It is a very second most powerful ligament in the body that is covering three important structures. Number one is nerve to gluteus. Number two is perineal nerve. You'll be seeing it in a matter of few milliseconds. So there are three structures which are very important. That is nerve to gluteus. This is known as perineal nerve. And then behind that is ischial spine. You can see it very clearly. And then from ischial spine, transversely, the structure which goes to the sacrum is sacrospinous ligament. You can see it very clearly. We have put a black thread inside that portion. Now, posterior in the gluteal region, this is what is very important and essential. We'll stop it here because we want to show you several different part together. The second important portion, what I'll tell you, is classically known as what is known as ischiorectal fossa. Now, this ischiorectal fossa is on lateral aspect of rectum. Here, the anatomy is very straightforward and simple. On the lateral aspect is obturator internus muscle, which is seen on the blue color. Medially is rectum and anal canal. Laterally is sacrotuberous ligament, which I have already shown you. And inferiorly is skin and subcutaneous area. This is the beginning of Alcock canal, which is shown by the green color area. You can see it very clearly. And from there, the pudendal nerves comes in and divides into two parts. One goes into the part which is giving vulva and labia major and minora. And second is hemorrhoidal part together. These are the pudendal nerves together. Thereafter, the dissection is from what is known as surgeon's dissection. From inside, when you see it very clearly, we can see that on the lateral side.
Here, the sacrospinous ligament is grasped with a Babcock clamp.
Medially is sacrum and the part is holding.
Although the following pelvic nerves cannot be seen without further dissection, posterior to the sacrospinous ligament, the inferior rectal,
and second is nerve to the gluteus. You can see it very clearly.
Levator ani
nerves together. Very essential part is if you put it close,
and pudendal nerves are located posterior to the ligament.
The ideal way,
superior to the upper border of the sacrospinous ligament lies the piriformis muscle, which can
go quickly because I want to show you a large amount of portions together. And therefore, once you start dissecting, there are several ways how we have given you what is known as animations together. This area is taken care of by three important Nebratsky's retractors. One medially dissecting the rectum, laterally is dissecting the portion. The horizontal transverse part is sacrospinous ligament. The very important thing is, even though if you have dissected out, the sacrospinous ligament is covered by coccygeus muscle, and that coccygeus muscle has to be dissected from lateral to medial side by few gauze pieces strict. And then only the sacrococcygeus muscle comes or ligament comes in the picture. You have to remember, you have to put the things 2 centimeter medial to ischial spine. That is how the area comes together. So therefore, if you look from the inside, that is the obturator muscle, obturator internus muscle. That is what is known as coccygeus muscle, which is covering the sacrospinous ligament. That is a coccygeus muscle. Then the third one is what is known as the sacral is completely covered by piriformis muscle, which is a soft belly together. And this is the part of the levator ani. If you go ahead, structure, you remove those two structures, sacrospinous and sacrotuberous ligament. But remember one thing, the pudendal nerve comes very close to ischial spine. And once it comes to ischial spine, you will have to avoid or safeguard it by taking a suture somewhere 2 centimeter from the portion, here somewhere in the portion. If you go too medially, inferior rectal nerves come in the picture together. You must also remember the inferior gluteal artery is also below the sacrospinous ligament. So don't take a deep and tough bite, otherwise there'll be a torrential bleeding together. And remember one thing. Remember, all the three give rise to different axes. And what is the importance in female urology? If you do a good sacrocolpopexy or urethropexy, then usually the posterior prolapse occur in almost 27% of the cases, which needs reoperation. While exactly opposite, if you do a good sacrospinous fixation, then you get a cystocele in almost 20% of the cases together. 20% will need what is known as operations together. The lastly, what is known as a rectovaginal, that comes from the perineal body right up to the ischial spine. It merges to uterosacral and cardinal complex together. This gives a very strong support posteriorly and keeps the uterus in an antiverted position. Now, many a times because of multiple deliveries, a multipara or an old age or diabetes or any other comorbidities, these rectovaginal septum can get injured either centrally, either laterally or combination therapy, and then can be give rise to what is known as a rectocele or a part of the rectocele complex together. And you can see it very clearly. The animation will show you medial portion, which is detached, lateral portion detached, inferior portion detached, or a combination portion detached together. These can be easily felt by what is known as a bimanual palpation. This is known as Richardson maneuver. One finger in the vagina and one finger rectum, you can easily find out where exactly is the low area and you can fix it, what is known as a selective part together. The last video I'm going to show you is what is known as what is the relation of ureter to uterosacral ligament. Uterosacral ligament is this. When you tilt the uterus, you can see it very clearly. The ureter always has a classical branch. In the proximal area, which is known as a sacral area, it is 3 to 4 centimeters of lateral to that. In the intermediate area, it is 1 to 2 centimeters. While in the cervical area, it is 1 centimeter. The principle here is when you are doing a high uterosacral fixation, you have to be very careful about the first part where you take absorbable sutures. Intermediate, you can take non-absorbable suture. The sacral, you can take non-absorbable suture. And you can see it very clearly. As a result, you can keep the ureter avoid because the chances of complication in this is almost 11% of together. So Dr. Soundarya? Dr. Soundarya?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I will close it here. I will take any questions from the student. Yes. I'll give you my email, what is known as amvaze or ajitvaze90@gmail.com. And people who are interested, they can ask me the question or you can email the question. And I sincerely thank Dr. Chandramohan, Dr. Soundarya for giving me an opportunity to give something totally different. Anatomy being the base of it, we have been speaking for almost an hour together in order to show or simplify the anatomy by different animation, which is ably aided by a cadaveric dissection in a part together. So I once again thank you for giving me an opportunity to speak that. If there is any questions, please feel free. I'm sure most of the, all the videos went smoothly. And I'm sure it get together. And I'm sure there are many questions which have people have in the mind. So it is difficult to answer all the questions because it will take half an hour to 45 minutes a day. But I'll give you the email. Soundarya has my email. And I will be very prompt in answering the email today evening itself to all the people together. And if there is any additional information, kindly feel free to do so. The second one, as and when Dr. Chandramohan gives me an opportunity to say, I will come back with a complexity of female urethra, which is also a very, very difficult topic. an absolutely neglected subject, and almost 40 to 45 minutes lecture I can give it there today.
Sir, few questions I like to ask you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, normally vesicovaginal fistula and urethrovaginal fistula.
Yes, sir.
If even around the trigone,
yes,
you
sir.
Do per urethrally, per vaginally, or transabdominal.
Most of the 99.9% I do it per vaginally.
Which position you put the patient, sir?
See, there are two positions. One is an exaggerated lithotomy position, or
in
what is known as a jackknife position.
In exaggerated lithotomy, head end should be kept fully down.
Should be kept about 30 degrees, just like a radical prostatectomy. This oncological surgeon keep the person. We keep it for half an hour. And
sir, do you take the stray stitches in the vagina before you give the incision around the fistula, or will you use the Foley's catheter?
So it's very essential to know. I put a Foley's catheter if the thing is less than 2 centimeters. But if it is a large fistula, we get a fistula almost 5.5 to 6 centimeters VVF. You can put the whole part together. Then you have to take stray sutures.
Sir, large fistula when you repair, you will not get the peritoneum so easily. The momentum. Is it required, or you will directly close in two layers?
No, sir. You need some part together because the tissues are not healthy. Number two, most of the patients who come to me, they come already operated 2 or 3 times outside. So they are redo cases. So we use extensively a Marsh's graft together. And I have even used a sartorial muscle also putting inside together.
So this Marsh's flap, you take the base from the anterior vessel or posterior, depending on what
the Marsh's flap has a dual bed supply, external,
yes,
iliac and internal iliac part together. So you can detach anywhere part together. Medially, the Marsh's flap, there are labial branches which are perforating, which are also giving rise to blood supply. So depending if it is a very high fistula, it is better to separate below. If it is a very low fistula, then you can take upper part together easily, no problem.
No.
Second important thing is Marsh's flap can be extended into the suprabibic area, and the suprabibic pad of fat also can be removed in addition together. So it gives a very robust, very vascular, very excellent fibrofatty layer with lymphatic, with blood supply, and gives a very good buttressing part between the bladder and a vagina together.
In case of intrinsic sphincter deficiency leading to incontinence, which procedure you like to do, sir? Autologous or any other procedure?
Always autologous. Always autologous. Because I have been following autologous for last 10 years, sir.
You take a horizontal strip from the rectus sheath, how many centimeters?
Always horizontal strip.
How many
I have no experience of arcus cutanea, lateral part of the fascia, because we don't have the...
So, in the abdomen, how much horizontal incision you will give, sir?
About 6 to 7 centimeter, good judicious use of rectus C-shaped retractor, which can be extended to 8-9 centimeter. It is very important that both the Hasselbalch triangle must be well demonstrated, because once the Hasselbalch triangle is well demonstrated, it is an avascular area. You do not injure any structure. It is extraperitoneal. And when you put endopelvic incision from vagina, you can put your finger and you can easily see the finger from the Hasselbalch triangle. And then on the tip of it, you put a needle, come down, and there pull the autologous fascia under vision upstairs. Now the very important part together is, why not put it medially? Many people, you will see it, they try to bring it as close to the midline as possible. This gives rise to voiding dysfunction. So therefore, the important part, the message was from the Melbourne Society of Dr. Helen O'Connell, that you take it on lateral aspect and 2 to 3 centimeter, through to almost 3 centimeter gap between the closed rectus abdominis fascia and a skin. That much amount of laxity of the part, you have to put it together. Believe me or not, once you do an autologous fascia, Many people all over the world do not do a TVT or TOT, which are synthetic meshes.
What is the logic except autologous versus mesh? Is there any logic that why TOT and TVT are fading off? Is it because of the foreign body or logically also the needle direction is not correct?
It's a very, very, very good question. Many urologists from Europe, which I know them very closely, are extremely opposing the idea that TVT is a wonderful procedure.
Yeah.
But because of certain people and a political pressure in England, it was stopped. Once English people stopped it, the Scottish people automatically stopped it. Second. Thereafter, New Zealand, Australia, and about 27 countries in the world have stopped it. In fact, it is a great loss to the incontinence women for a very simple operation. Once the learning curve is over, it's a beautiful operation. I have a follow-up of almost 22 years plus of the TVT. I have no problem whatsoever. So if it's such a good operation, the operation can be over in less than 5 minutes time. What is the problem? I don't understand. The chances it gives rise to what is known as extrusion. The extrusion rate all over the world is less than 1.3. That is not a great thing to talk about.
Sir, one more common condition is isolated cystocele. Yes, normally people repair from vagina, open the vaginal wall and remove some amount of the vaginal wall and close in buttress effect. Is it a good operation in your point?
First and foremost important thing, do not touch the cystocele unless it is symptomatic.
Yeah.
Asymptomatic cystocele should not be operated, should not be treated. You just keep them under observation, number one. Number two is most of the small cystocele which are symptomatic will have urgency frequency, and a very large grade 3 or grade 4 cystocele will have obstructive pattern of it. Third, very essential, in a large cystocele, it is very wise to push the cystocele, keep a pessary, and then do urodynamic and rule out that there is no concomitant stress incontinence erect. Because if you close the cystocele and the patient becomes incontinent, it is a very shameful act. So in this situation, the procedure of choice is do a urodynamic and prove that there is no stress incontinence. If in doubt, today also, we do in two stages. We do repair the cystocele part together. Here, previously, we used to use a mesh, but today the mesh is completely contraindicated because the patient reads on the Google or a different part together, and they say, we don't want mesh together. So what I do is I use rectus fascia as a part together to give a buttressing part. You do get a good amount of rectus fascia. If the problem continues, you can take a fairly large amount of Thompson's fascia, which I showed you, the posterior rectus sheet. Excellent measure. You can get a very good part together and tell them that we will observe you for 3 weeks' time. If you ever get incontinent, we'll do a tape together. But very simple and very small part, I want to tell you, Dr. Chandramohan, that don't take a common incision going over the bladder neck, because bladder neck is an area, it is an area of important parts together. It is a crucial elasticity, fibers are going through that. So it is better to take two separate incisions, one for the TVT or TOT, if at all she comes after 3 months with stress incontinence. And second is a cystocele. You can take a vertical or a U-shaped incision separately. But keep the bladder neck area completely safe and do not touch it. Absolutely very important and very essential part today.
Sir, one more thing. In case of cystocele or vaginal prolapse, vault prolapse, any prolapse, if it is minor or major, if the patient is symptomatic, many people say that sacrocolpopexy laparoscopic is the single answer for all prolapses.
I agree. I am one gentleman. I talk to all my gynecologist friends. I got lots of gynecologist friends. I tell them, please, we will do laparoscopic sacrocolpopexy. And we have done several ways of doing a sacrocolpopexy. We can fix the uterus in the sacral region by few tapes, and the same mesh, namely the polypropylene type 1 monofilament, works wonderfully well in such situation.
Yes.
While inside on the anterior portion, we strengthen the round ligament with the help of a same mesh which is put together inside the peritoneum, and they work very well.
Very well.
Frankly telling you, I mean, my knowledge of gynecology is very minimum, but unless there is a malignancy, I do not tell them that do hysterectomy. But luckily, Chandramohanji, the hysterectomy rates have also come down drastically, even in gynecological people.
Yeah.
They have also realized it. What they do, if there is a large fibroid, previously they used to do removal of the fibroid, myomectomy and hysterectomy together. Now only they do myomectomy and keep the uterus.
Yes.
Hysterectomically
correct.
Absolutely perfectly. Because if you remove the uterus, the central support of bladder and the rectum completely goes away.
Sir, my last question, where are we now regarding the Bursch Colpo suspension and any retropubic surgeries? What are the indications for retropubic open suspension or any needle techniques? Where are we now, sir?
I do get a patients who have collagen disorders, especially collagen 3 disorders. These are the young girls who are not married and they need their uterus. You cannot put mid-urethral sling in a woman who has not had completed the delivery or their 1 or 2 babies program. So in this patient, we usually tell them that we'll do Bursch Colpo suspension. These patients are very far and few. Maybe once in 1 or 2 years, they come to me, but they get a very good and very satisfied. Second important thing is I am attached to quite a few athletic people. And in the athletic girls, also because of a huge amount of part together, they do get sometimes stress incontinence, and it is very bothersome for them. They are unmarried girls, they are young girls, very fit girls. So we tell them that we do laparoscopic Bursch Colpo
suspension.
2 sutures on both the side, and you can see you get a very good result. And because there is no scar, she doesn't have to explain to the would-be husband or would-be in-laws that why is the scar there on the abdominal wall.
Very nice.
Laparoscopy does have part, but far and few and very few people. Unmarried, athletic girl, people who have not completed the pregnancy, they still have the marriage on the bay or hand. These are the ladies. Bursch Colpo suspension is not given a procedure. And laparoscopy, if you are good in laparoscopy, you can do a good job by laparoscopy. It's an excellent procedure.
Soundari, you want to ask any question?
Yes, sir. If cystocele associated with SUI, like looking like intrinsic sphincter deficiency.
Can you little make it little big? Go ahead.
Hello, sir.
Loud sound.
Speak loudly.
Cystocele associated with SUI, that is like intrinsic sphincter deficiency.
Correct.
What will be their ideal choice of procedure, sir?
Most of the time, if it is intrinsic sphincter deficiency, usually in this patient, TOT is not the way to go about. So we have to do either autologous. Most of the time, I prefer autologous. But in certain individual, I still give them a choice of TVT. I show them films. I show them other things. Today, the TVT, it comes in a different form, what is known as TVT exact. And that comes with a very small stem, which I showed you during the cadaveric dissection. And that is very easy procedure to follow. And once you have completed about 60, 70 TVT, then it's not a difficult problem. It can be said.
Okay? So at the same time, you repair the cystocele also, sir?
Cystocele, usually, you have to understand the cystocele, if it is symptomatic, if she has a stress incontinence, which is demonstrated after pushing back the cystocele and putting a pessary, we do concomitant procedure together. Yes, we do that.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Excellent session. My God, knowledge you have and interest, the amount of enthusiasm to teach is exceptional. And as I will type your email in the chat box so that it will be there forever with your permission. If you tell your email address, I will type it here, sir, now only.
AMVAZE. V for victory, A for Andrew, Z for zebra, E for England. At hotmail.com.
At hotmail.com. So, dear audience, sir is kind enough that he is giving his email. So, those who are interested in female urology, please go through this and kindly be in touch with sir so that he is ready to answer. I'm really grateful, sir.
Thank you very much. The credit goes to you rather than me, sir.
No, sir. It's really you have put efforts in the videos.
If you give me a chance next time,
yes, sir.
I will show you the vaginal anatomy. When you do a lithotomy position,
yes, sir.
Without touching the skin, what are the structure we are inside? I have a full 55 minutes of presentation.
Yes, sir. We'll definitely do, sir.
I will show you different parts of the fistulas which you do, starting from simple to almost complex obstetric fistula. Because forget about the last 2 years, but yes, with a close friend of mine called Doc, he's from Belgium. We go to Congo and we repair the obstetric fistula. So I will be able to show you some videos of obstetric fistula. That is a different ball game altogether.
Yes, sir. We will definitely do. Nearly 200 audience have seen the program and this link will be available forever. So even Venugopal sir has called me and asked for the link. I have given, probably is watching. In fact, he wanted to listen this program particularly. So
sir is my teacher and sir, I have learned so much thing from you that I still consider myself as a student of Professor P. Venugopal.
Great, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you once again.
Thank you.